and welcome to the Presto Music Podcast. Those that have been following the podcast from the beginning will know that one of the most intriguing and interesting shows last year was the Scandinavian sojourn we took with critic and broadcaster Andrew Meller, a journey that began where Andrew lives, in Copenhagen, with the Danish composer Carl Nielsen. So we thought it would be a great idea to invite Andrew back to take a closer look at the life and music of one of classical music's most idiosyncratic figures, which he has very kindly agreed to do. Welcome back, Andrew. What have you been up to since we spoke around this time last year?
Thanks, Paul. Good to be back. In a sense, not a lot, like everybody else. It's been a busy year, thankfully. And, our concert life here in Copenhagen is up and running with a vengeance. So that's been good. And obviously, I've had some fantastic podcasts from you to listen to as well.
Thank you very much. What was it that drew you and continues to draw you to the music of Carl Nielsen? And was it the love of Nielsen that drew you to Denmark, or vice versa?
Well, I think it was the prospect of a better life that drew me to Denmark. Maybe Carl Nielsen was a small part of it. And actually, I moved in 2015, which was the 150th anniversary of Carl Nielsen's birth, of course, as well as Sibelius's. So that perhaps pushed me a little bit over the edge as well. I think I actually approached Nielsen through Sibelius, which is probably a mistake. I think a lot of people tend to do that. And so that's why it took me kind of a while to warm to him. Once you sort of get Sibelius out of your head and think of Nielsen as a completely different entity musically, then I think it's sort of slightly easier. So I was just captured eventually by this energizing effect of his music, this very sort of physical energy that I think you get from Nielsen's music. And then, the more I dug in, the more I found him a fascinating figure, his life as well as his music.
Can you briefly describe Carl Nielsen's early life and personality, a personality which seems remarkably well expressed in his Opus 1 Little Suite for Strings, quite possibly the most characterful Opus 1 I think I've ever heard?
Yeah, I agree. And Nielsen was, in a sense, his upbringing, his childhood is kind of vital for his whole career, his whole life. He was born in this very poor family, one of, I think, seven children or something, a similar figure, on the island of Funen, as we call it in English, a place with a sort of very distinctive landscape. He played in a band with his father, a kind of traveling wedding band. He played the fiddle, and there's a great story in which he improvised a solo once uninvited, and apparently the look on his father's face told him that he shouldn't try that again anytime soon. And then he moved from that band to play in the local barracks band, where he played the bugle and the alto trombone. So he was really a composer sort of absolutely raised in the folk music tradition, unlike Grieg and Sibelius, who had to sort of come at that tradition through their own education. A real folk musician, an ordinary guy, a poor child who, for whom the local community had to sort of whip round money to send him to audition at the Royal Danish Academy of Music. And that's where he ended up, and that's where he wrote this Opus 1 Suite for Strings. And, he had a good relationship with Niels Gehl, the Danish composer who was head of the Academy. He liked Gehler, Gehler liked Nielsen, but at the same time, Gehler really couldn't stomach this music that Nielsen was writing and dismissed it as too messy. And that was really the kind of start of Nielsen's journey on his own. He wanted to completely reinvent the way Scandinavian music sounded and move it away from the German school, which Gehler had been associated with. You have this fantastic middle movement. I think that's the movement we're going to hear, isn't it? Which is a kind of tongue-in-cheek waltz, and I think even here you can sense Nielsen's kind of personality emerging.
And here it's performed by the Sinfonietta Riga, conducted by Klaus Efflund. Thank you. The characterfulness and humanity of his writing is here in his Opus 1, and it's something that stayed with Nielsen through his entire career, isn't it?
It is, yeah. And, you know, we don't have time, unfortunately, to play his symphonies 1 and 2. But, of course, you know, 4 or 5 years after that suite came Nielsen's first symphony, which radically changed the kind of idea of the symphony for not just Scandinavia but Europe. You know, the first symphony with progressive tonality. It was a piece that begins in the wrong key. You know, every movement kind of has this kind of this sense of chaos at the beginning. Like all the first whole Nielsen's first four symphonies all have this sense of chaos that they open with, and really a kind of common man's view of the world described as like a child playing with dynamite by one of the Copenhagen critics. I think he meant it as a compliment, you know, like just sort of originality, the fact that it was so changeable and so engaging. So, I mean, we're not hearing the first symphony, but we are hearing this violin sonata, which I wanted to include it because we don't often hear Nielsen's chamber music. And there's some fantastic chamber music from Nielsen. And this sonata, which I think was a year after the symphony, 1895, opens again with this sense of just extreme individuality and, you know, this breathlessness, this disruption. And yeah, I think we're going to hear a bit from the first movement. But you, Paul, hear it slightly differently to me, I think, don't you?
Yeah, well, I tend to hear it as quite highly enjoyable, but quite archetypal late romantic sonata. Can you address what qualities were seen as avant-garde at the time?
Well, I mean, it's a good question. I'm not sure it was, you know, it's easy to see it as avant-garde in retrospect, which I do. I mean, you have this violin line that doesn't, you just, you know, you think, where on earth is that going from the moment it starts? And then you have a piano accompaniment, which can seem more in some performances than others, which can seem totally unrelated to that violin line. And I think about, you know, the late Beethoven quartets where he plays these games with meter, so you don't quite know what meter the music's in, you know, and sometimes half of the music's in one meter and half of it's in the other, divided into instrumentally. And so I think you get that here. So it's a subtle but sort of, to me, quite fascinating view of that kind of his strange take, Nielsen's very strange take on the legacy of Brahms, Beethoven, and this very fresh-faced, kind of spiky-haired approach. Yeah, listen to the violin melody, listen to the piano accompaniment, and see if you can try and reconcile them, because in a wonderful way, I can't.
And we can listen to it performed by John Gesmer and Jens Elvekjær. Was Nielsen seen as a bit of an enfant terrible in Danish musical circles?
Well, it's funny because there's actually a Danish musicologist who has written a lot about this. Nielsen's kind of seen very much one way inside Denmark and another way outside of Denmark. So I don't think he was seen as an enfant terrible as much as an original who kind of the country was quite willing to get behind. You know, that Denmark was in a period of real transition when Nielsen was maturing. It kind of lost more than half of its landmass, all of its colonies. It had to kind of rebuild from within. And Nielsen's idea of musical simplicity, of, you know, basing his music on quite simple ingredients, kind of, I think, struck a chord with people inside Denmark. I mean, obviously they got to know his songs, his popular songs, a lot more than they did his more avant-garde symphonies. But still, I think he was seen as an original, but not so much as an enfant terrible. He was certainly seen as a kind of country boy made good. And, you know, they loved that. The Danes loved that. They had it in Hans Christian Andersen. They felt guilty about Hans Christian Andersen having been treated so badly. So when Nielsen came along from the same place as Andersen, from the same island, I think they felt, here's someone we should kind of get behind, and they did get behind him.
Isn't this part of this idea of sort of Denmark reinventing itself? As you said, in 1864, which was the year before Nielsen was born, they lost this war against Prussia very badly, as you said, lost half their territory. So it's a country trying to searching for a new expression of itself, perhaps.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, you know, they have this phrase, what was lost on the outside shall be gained on the inside. And that, you could argue, lies behind the whole Danish interior design trend that's kind of come to fruition in the 20th century and 21st century. The whole idea of, you know, beauty in simple things. You might as well have a coffee jug that's as beautiful as a marble sculpture. I think you can say that all very much came from 1864.
Well, when we spoke last, you agreed that the Third Symphony was the most Danish of his symphonies. How does it reflect changing Danish society in the early 20th century?
Well, I think one of the interesting things about this symphony is that many people were moving from the country to the city round about the turn of the 20th century. You know, Denmark, the Industrial Revolution was a little bit later than it was in Britain, further south in Europe. So Nielsen himself had made that journey. And for me, this symphony is kind of emblematic of the two sides of his personality, the kind of country bumpkin and the city sophisticate. You know, he was kind of forced to adopt this role of the part of the elite, I suppose, in Copenhagen, and yet he never ever lost sight of his roots, and his music certainly didn't lose sight of his roots. So I mean, quite apart from the fact that you have this in the last movement, you have this very broad tune, which is kind of speaks to me very obviously of the landscape of Fun and the horizon, the kind of rolling hills, the hard work of the farmer and the plough. You also have, and of course in the slow movement, you also have these two voices picking out a wordless melody, which is again sense of, you know, the open expanse of the landscape in Funen. But in the first movement, which is the movement we're going to hear from, you have this kind of theme, like, that's very reminiscent of the Eroica, Beethoven's Eroica, the triad, that kind of crashes into a kind of urban waltz, like a kind of sophisticated posh waltz, and there's a kind of wonderful moment of rupture, and it seems to me very much a picture of Nielsen, the country lad, coming to terms, or not coming to terms actually, with Nielsen, the sort of urban dweller who all the kind of city dwellers looked up to.
And that's a journey that many of his contemporaries were making at the same time, of course.
Yeah, it was, precisely. And actually, you know, they would have arrived in Copenhagen at this central station, which is the building that stands today, Copenhagen Central, which opened in 1911, the year Nielsen was writing this symphony. And, you know, there are many parallels. It has a very intricate wooden roof, like an upturned Viking ship, very much kind of new natural materials. It's plain, functional. It speaks of hard work, bricks, wood. And you can hear all those things, I think, in the Third Symphony.
Yeah, well, let's hear it performed by the Royal Danish Orchestra, conducted by Leonard Bernstein. I've always felt that throughout his oeuvre, Nielsen has a unique and distinct sonority. Do you agree? And what is it, do you think, that gives it this quality?
Yeah, I definitely agree. It's hard to pinpoint. I mean, we just heard the triad there in the Third Symphony. He does often build his music on quite simple ingredients, purposefully. You know, like the simplicity of song, the vigour of the dance, And even in a piece like the Fifth Symphony, where, you know, which is sort of seen as very avant-garde, the bass materials are quite simple. Bernstein, who conducted that performance and came to Copenhagen and conducted Nielsen's pieces, was very keen on the kind of unpredictability of the composer. What did he refer to it as? Nielsen's constant unpredictability. That's something that the idea of kind of impoliteness, of bump and grind, and of kind of rural directness, and also, you know, this very sophisticated counterpoint that sometimes makes an appearance but is never, you know, too in your face, I think, of all things I would associate with him, as well as just a really great view of, you know, history. He played as a violinist so much music. He knew his music, I think.
Well, genre we haven't managed to fit an excerpt from is his songs. Can you explain the continued importance of Nielsen's songs within Denmark? And why has this marked him as a truly national composer? As you said, someone whose music is known even to those who are infrequent visitors to the concert hall or opera house.
Yeah, Nielsen was part of a few people who were responsible for creating this kind of songbook. It's called the Folkehøjskolens Melodibog, like a kind of compendium of songs that are sung in high schools in Denmark, still are, and that this book is constantly discussed in the media still because it's just had a new edition out, and, you know, often people are asking, should it include songs with kind of Arabic text? Should it include songs from outside the Danish tradition? That sort of thing. But Nielsen was one of the people who compiled it, and he contributed hundreds of songs to it too. So many of his songs are just known as almost like Danish folk songs, although he wrote them from scratch. I mean, it's not an exaggeration to say the vast majority of Danes will know one or two of these songs, probably five or six of them, despite professing to not know any Carl Nielsen. Yeah, and they, you know, often simple themes. The most famous, Jens Weiermann, Jens the road mender, about a guy who, you know, the guy who mended the streets, and they're charming. Some of them are more towards kind of Lieder and have a little more substance, and some are just kind of very charming, simple songs. And, you know, you can hear the melodies. I think the melody from Jens Weiermann, Jens the Roadmender, some musicologists have believe it crops up in the Fifth Symphony, you know, absolutely his most sophisticated score. So he didn't want necessarily to see too much of a divide between those two entities.
I gather there's a list of great Danish cultural artefacts. Music-wise, there's two pieces by Nielsen, and also the folk collection, there's also pieces by Nielsen is there. He crosses both those worlds in Danish culture.
Yeah, he does very much. But of course, that collection, the cultural canon, as they call it.
Cultural canon.
This is never out of the news either. I mean, a new culture minister comes along and they say, oh, we're going to look at the cultural canon again. And, you know, everyone's talking, debating about Carl Nielsen and the other songwriters. I mean, yeah, it goes on and on.
Well, Denmark is fortunate that it has a national opera with Nielsen's Maskarade. Is that status primarily due to its music, characters, plot, or a combination of the three?
I think it's definitely a combination of those things. But I mean, the plot helps, you know, because it's a very Danish story about the new generation coming along to replace the old generation and kind of modernity, I suppose. Like, the fundamental story is a group of young people who want to party, and the older people in Copenhagen thinking that they're making too much of a noise, and so, you know, trying to cancel the party. And you can see this just happening every summer in Copenhagen, you know, still. And there's a great line in the opera about, you know, what else should we do living in a country where the sun shines only once a year? Yeah. And, you know, when the sun comes out, Copenhageners really do go wild. And I see that very much represented in Maskarade. But, you know, the other thing is that it's, you know, it's almost an operetta in some ways. And Nielsen had played Falstaff, the Danish premiere of Falstaff, when he was in the opera orchestra. I definitely think there are parallels with Falstaff.
The plot's written by Holberg, and that's from Grieg's Holberg Suite.
That's right, yeah. I think it was over 100 years old, wasn't it, when Nielsen took it up and set it as an opera. And Holberg was associated with the Royal Theatre, where Nielsen played the violin and was later a conductor. And yeah, I think, you know, it's kind of woven into the cultural DNA, like you were saying about the culture canon. People know the plot, and people know the kind of main aria that the Euronymous sings, which is a sort of picture of a fusty old man trying to preserve, you know, traditions that never really existed. And that's the kind of, he sings that and then gets knocked off his perch by the youngsters straight afterwards.
Fantastic. Well, something we touched on last time was the dichotomy between Scandinavian art and its people. Are the Danes quite happy keeping their national opera a comedy to themselves?
Oh, that's a good question. You know, I've been thinking a lot about this. I've just written a book. I think last time we spoke, I was telling you about it, about trying to get to the bottom of this idea of, you know, Nordic identity in music. And the Danes absolutely love it when one of their own kind of people makes a success abroad, you know, like Kasper Holten or someone like that, or Kasper Schmeichel for that matter. But they kind of are very confused about success in their own country and how to sort of deal with it, because you're not supposed to be seen as anything, you know, kind of special. And I think they find it rather charming, you know, when Masquerade is performed abroad. It was done at Covent Garden, I think, wasn't it, in 2006 or something. And I think the British sort of were a little bit nonplussed by it. But I mean, I think maybe this is an example of an opera that perhaps doesn't travel so well. And certainly, if you think of it as a pantomime, you know, that's done at Christmas, it's not exclusively done at Christmas, but it's, since I moved to Copenhagen, it seems to have been done at Christmas. And it's sort of a traditional kind of pantomime style piece.
And here's the finale of Act One of Masquerade, performed by soloists and the Danish National Symphony Orchestra and Choir, conducted by Michael Schoenvandt. Well, the second symphony that you've picked from it is his Fifth Symphony. Now, Denmark watched from the sidelines the horrors of the First World War. Is the Fifth Symphony a rare chance to see a European, but yet at the same time, outsider's perspective on the conflict?
Yes, I mean, it was about the war, but it was also kind of bigger than that, because I think Nielsen's, he saw the conflict in southern, further south in Europe as a metaphor for bigger things, you know, humanity's sort of struggle, moral struggle. He was also having his own serious problems at the time. His marriage was collapsing. He was kind of ostracized from Copenhagen. He was spending a lot of time in Gothenburg, where he felt, you know, he felt people understood him, but actually in reality, it was probably that people didn't know that he'd had all sorts of affairs and illegitimate children. So yes, it to some extent, it was about looking from afar at events further south in Europe. But I think also it was a bit more broad and also more close to home. When we think of Sibelius, for example, you know, the Fourth Symphony, Sibelius was very keen to sort of pick up on expressionistic musical trends from Europe that he was hearing. We often think of that symphony as all about, you know, his own moment of bleakness, but he was definitely trying to do things musically as well. And I think the same is true of Nielsen's Fifth. A lot of it was just, how can I advance this idea of symphonic design, this idea of symphonic energy? You know, the first four symphonies, we have this tremendous sense of energy, and they're kind of let, in the first three, they're let off to sort of fly free. And then in the fourth and fifth, they encounter this kind of overwhelming negative force. And perhaps you could say in the fifth, they don't quite prevail. You know, there's this sense of a bit like the pandemic, you know, that there's always a little bit of the kind of darkness left. The weeds are still growing in between the cracks, even at the end of the symphony. So, yeah. And you know, it has this amazing expressionistic snare drum solo, which in purely in musical terms was fascinating, you know, to have a to instruct a musician to sort of improvise and do anything possible in order to make a sort of the desired sound was pretty radical at the time.
We could sample that now, performed by the New York Philharmonic, conducted by Alan Gilbert. Now, the prominent use of a snare drum in Nielsen's music isn't unique to the Fifth Symphony. Do you feel there's something particular about this instrument that appealed to Nielsen? Is the disruptive element of it a representation of his own character or what he wanted to achieve, perhaps?
Yeah, definitely. I think that's absolutely right. And we should also consider that, you know, when he was playing in that barracks band, Nielsen wrote in his memoirs about the sound of this army barracks band, you know, the cacophony it made, the drums, the brass instruments, something about like a foaming sea full of monsters writhing around. And he loved that. And that's definitely stayed with him. And I think, you know, there must have been drums in that band. And I think he just relished the idea that there could be a troll in the orchestra, you know, that could kind of get at other instruments and get at other elements of the musical conversation.
It can't be drowned out.
Exactly.
He's going to be the loudest voice.
Yeah, and you know, it was in a sense him, you know, because he was sort of this cheeky presence all his life, and he never really wanted to sort of conform. And perhaps I think he always felt like the poor kid from Funen, and maybe, you know, this was his way of, you know, kind of enacting his revenge on polite society.
Well, I listened to this symphony again, obviously in preparation for the show, and I was actually struck, actually this time around, by its modernism. Yet it's never at the expense of the music's humanity. Is this perhaps Nielsen's greatest achievement musically? Is that he was able to marry this musical modernism with his own outgoing character and personality?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, again, I think that's a really good way of putting it. I mean, I think he always wanted to be honest. And I think he was very conscious of not repeating himself and also of, you know, trying to develop his language wherever he could and find new ways of expressing his fundamental worldview, which was this, you know, the life force and the human spirit versus, you know, negative forces, whether that be death or kind of moral corruption or whatever. It's funny because I think a lot of people still find Nielsen's music quite difficult, you know, and so I would hesitate to say that he kind of managed to manifest those things in music that's kind of very easy, because a lot of the time it's not very easy. And even the Fifth Symphony can be quite difficult to listen to. Well, I think the Sixth Symphony maybe is even easier if it's an easier symphony to experience if you don't know anything about the symphony. Sometimes, you know, people like you and me, we kind of listen with this weight of, you know, knowledge about what the symphony should be, and you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I'm not sure. I mean, I think maybe I'm too close to him to know the answer to that. But I mean, I certainly think so. And I think in some of his most beautiful, simple music, you just feel absolute honesty, and the kind of innovation wears it very lightly.
Well, as we said, Nielsen was very successful in Denmark. But was his success a source of irritation for some of the perhaps more avant-garde colleagues in Danish composition, in particular one Ruud Langgaard?
Yes, indeed. Yeah. Ruud Langgaard. This guy really hated Nielsen. And I mean, it's funny. I mean, it's funny, but I mean, it had its tragic side to it as well. But I mean, you know, the Danish kind of culture life kind of latched onto Nielsen, like I was saying earlier, and he became a kind of emblem. Meanwhile, Hu Langgaard was a composer who was in a sense much more traditional, actually. Like, he was much more of a romantic at heart, and he just couldn't accept that, you know, the kind of musical language had moved on. And Nielsen advocated for this more austere, contrapuntal, simple style, and Langgaard was very much a kind of mystic. And Langgaard was treated very badly in Denmark, partly because he was seen as out of fashion, but also because, you know, he was the absolute opposite to Nielsen. He came from privilege. He had these kind of slightly Germanic aristocratic links. You know, that didn't really do him any favours at the time. And the more success Nielsen had, the more bitter and angry Langgaard became. And, you know, I mean, Langgaard, in the end, he did, you know, create some really visionary masterpieces. You know, he foreshadowed Ligeti, and his language just shot off in all sorts of amazing directions. But he did also write these eccentric pieces, like the one we're going to hear, in which he just let loose and about what he felt about Carl Nielsen. And this piece, which obviously wasn't performed until I think the kind of 1980s, 1990s, when Denmark took a good look at all of Langgaard's works and decided to give them fair dues. He simply has a choir sing one phrase. Carl Nielsen for store companies. Carl Nielsen, our great composer, over and over, getting louder and louder. And I think the score says at the end, it says to be sung for all eternity. And you know, I mean, he obviously wasn't gifted with a great subtle approach to irony, but still, it's fascinating to hear. So I think we hear a bit, but I mean, you can imagine. You just have to imagine it going on and on and on and on.
We're not going to listen for all eternity, but you can sample what we could sample of. Carl Nielsen, Our Great Composer by Ruud Langgaard. This is performed by the Danish National Radio Symphony Orchestra and Choir, conducted by Gennady Rozdestvensky. Not exactly the most subtle work of art, is it, Andrew?
Certainly not, no. But I mean, it's just amazing to think that he was so frustrated that he sat down and wrote this, you know? Like, a few years ago, I did some research into Hu Langgaard, and I was very interested to see what, you know, to hear about Nielsen's reaction to him. And I think Nielsen just didn't really, no one really knew of his existence for a lot of the time. It's kind of like,
oh, no,
that
that's
guy.
That's the worst, isn't it?
Yeah, like, whatever. Oh, he's done another piece. Okay, whatever. It must have been very tough for him.
Well, Nielsen's opera, Saul and David, is one of Nielsen's most accomplished scores, but it's probably fair to say that the piece has never really taken off in Denmark or abroad. Is this perhaps because it's too Wagnerian to be accepted as authentically Danish, but not Wagnerian enough?
Yeah, it's certainly not Wagnerian enough. I mean, I think Nielsen was at the time, you know, starting to really dislike the whole Wagner project and trying to sort of move away from what he called the gravy and grease of German music. But also, he was in this kind of lyrical phrase pre the Third Symphony. The Saul and David, I mean, it has its problems. You know, the plot, it's quite sort of congested, and but I just think it has some wonderful music in, like you said, and And we got to hear it in 2015 on the anniversary. And I hear rumblings of a new recording, perhaps from the UK, but, you know, I don't know whether that will come to fruition. But it has some wonderfully innovative moments. Like the opening chorus I've always found very striking. But the bit we're going to hear, which is the prelude to Act Two, isn't it, I think, it's a piece that's plucked out and played a lot in concert and also used to test conductors. It just has this wonderful lyricism and shows his contrapuntal skill, his orchestration, the way he can write a fantastic counter melody and create these moments of rupture. And it's just so bracing, so wonderfully energetic and bracing. I love it.
And it's performed here by the Danish National Symphony Orchestra, conducted by Thomas Dausgaard. Yeah, when I was listening to this, I found that the most distinct passages were actually those orchestral-only pieces. I did find that the vocal writing often does sound a bit Meistersinger-ish.
Yeah, that's a good point. And I think Nielsen was perhaps yet to master his treatment of the Danish language in an operatic context. You know, like Masquerade is very quick and linguistic, and Saul and David is a little more, yeah, exactly as you say, maybe unconsciously Wagnerian, actually. I mean, he played the Meistersinger in the pit at the Royal Opera. I don't think he could help but be influenced by it, perhaps.
Well, on the Presto podcast about Handel, we discussed the affiliation that Britain had with the Israelites in Handel's oratorios. Is there something similar going on here with Denmark's relationship to Germany? And perhaps Nielsen's relationship to Wagner? Is Nielsen seeing himself as the David versus Wagner's Goliath?
Ooh, yeah, maybe. I mean, I think maybe it goes back to Nielsen's. I mean, you know, you have to remember that throughout the sort of 19th century, the whole of the Scandinavian music scene was kind of dominated by Germany. So everyone went down to Leipzig. They either went to Copenhagen or they went to Leipzig. You know, Grieg went to Leipzig. Niels Gehr went to Leipzig, ran the Gewandhaus, then came back. So Copenhagen then almost became an extension of Leipzig. And Nielsen just wanted something of his own, for Denmark to have something of its own, just like Grieg. And, you know, it's fascinating how they both subtly tweaked, well, I suppose Grieg subtly tweaked what he learned from the German school and created this very distinct, fresh Norwegian language. And Nielsen, I suppose, went more fundamentally for, you know, structure. He wanted shorter phrases. He wanted more abrupt rhythms. He wanted more kind of grinding harmonies. And that was his way of, you know, his sort of bid for musical separatism, I suppose. And I think, you know, Denmark needed it. As you were saying about 1864, this was a time when Denmark just needed to stand on its own two feet. And, you know, this rumbled on into the 20th century when there was more disputes about the land, Schleswig-Holstein, and of course the wars when Denmark was in the Second World War occupied by Germany. I mean, Denmark, Nielsen was long dead at that point, but still, it's become a way of looking at Nielsen and celebrating what he did. Just last year, Schleswig-Holstein celebrated its centenary of being back in Danish hands. And there was lots of performances of the music that Carl Nielsen actually wrote in 1920 to mark that occasion. So yeah, it is different and it sounds different and it, you know, it's linguistically different. And I think that's one of the reasons why perhaps we find it as English speakers difficult to grasp at first.
Yeah, and it is connected to the Danish language, that setting of it. It has to be specifically tailored to the very different language that is between Danish and German.
Yes, I think so. You know, Danish sits at the back of the throat. And it sounds like, well, the Norwegians say that Danes speak as though they've got a throat full of potatoes. And it's got a very distinct sound. To me, a very sort of harsh staccato sound in some ways. You know, it's a language that's fantastic to be angry in. It's insults and curses and you know, things you shout out the car window. They sound a lot better in Danish than in any other language. And I've always thought the opening of the fourth symphony, the opening of the third symphony, the opening of the first symphony, it just sounds linguistically very Danish to me.
Well, Nielsen wrote three concertos for violin, flute and for clarinet. Now, the clarinetist for whom Nielsen wrote the piece was called irascible but warm at heart. Is this a pretty good description of the concerto itself?
Yes, I think it is. Nielsen's these late concertos, the flute and clarinet concerto and the bassoon concerto that never came to fruition, were designed for Nielsen's ex-colleagues in the Royal Danish Orchestra, who also played in this wind quintet that Nielsen wrote his famous wind quintet for. Like I said, you know, he never wanted to repeat himself. He always wanted to develop his musical kind of voice. And later on in his career, he had this idea that in order to write for an instrument, you had to kind of creep inside that instrument and kind of, you know, get inside its character. Stereotype, what we probably would think of now, you know, instrumental stereotypes. But this guy, Auger Oxenthal, who was the clarinetist in the Royal Danish Orchestra, was, just a real character, irascible. And a guy, Robert Simpson, described him as full of personal subjective problems. Who knows what that means? But, you know, I imagine a guy who was fun to be around in the evening, maybe not so much fun to be around the next morning.
Good morning. Yeah, you mentioned there the wind quintet. He's certainly such an idiomatic writer for wind instruments, isn't he, Carl Nielsen?
Yes, he is. And he really wanted to sort of like, you know, the flute for him was this kind of forest bound, you know, like fawn like instrument. The clarinet was a sort of, a screeching tram or a lyrical, you know, kind of bird. He very much went for these specific characteristics.
Well, let's sample the clarinet concerto performed by Blaz Sparovets, the Odense Symphony Orchestra, conducted by Anna Skrileva. It does go back to that idea that Nielsen is really a master of musical character, isn't he? Whether that's his or someone else's.
Yes, I think so. And you know, he really wanted to do something different in that piece and the flute concerto. And there's a hint of atonality in there. There's also that, you know, that very kind of, we didn't hear it there, but the concerto opens with this very sort of bumpkin-like theme. You know, you can imagine Nielsen the kid wandering through Odense with his little trumpet slung over his shoulder, very kind of ordinary. And then we talked about the snare drum that acts as a kind of troll towards the clarinet all the way through, the confrontation of it, the fact that it, you know, in 1928 this would have sounded like very modernist music. And there was a terrible review, wasn't there, where someone wrote in Sweden, absolutely the worst thing that this too obviously experimental and provocatively sidestepping Dane has yet written.
And is there a bit of jealousy there from a Swede?
Well, I think first of all, like, the Swedes have always been more conservative, and Nielsen would have loved that, you know, like, to upset a Swede would have been a real badge of honor to him. But I also, there's also the sense that, you know, to upset any critic would have been pretty good going for him, because he never wanted to sort of become part of the establishment. And, you know, as long as what he did had integrity and wasn't provoking for its own sake, and was rooted in what you described as character, I think he was very happy to sort of stand by it.
Well, Andrew's final pick is Nielsen's Sixth Symphony, his last. Now, if Stravinsky deconstructed classical music's rhythmic language and Schoenberg deconstructed its harmonic, perhaps Nielsen, with his Sixth Symphony, again striking his own path, wanted to take on classical music's perceived sense of self-importance, again showing his character from those early photos and his music.
Yeah, very much so. And I think that the older Nielsen got, you know, the more he kind of wanted to recapture his youth, and his autobiography, My Childhood, Min Barnd on Pufunen, My Childhood on Funen, was actually written, I think, just before, no, not long before he died. He spent a lot of time in his later years harking back to his early years and his sort of childlike self, and you certainly hear this in the symphony. I mean, you know, in the 1920s, he had a heart attack. He was ordered to rest, and instead of resting, he went skiing, broke two ribs, and then just before he died, he was larking around at the back of the theatre for a revival of Masquerade, actually, climbing up ropes with some of the stagehands, you know, which then killed him effectively. He went straight to hospital and died some days later. So he kind of never grew up, in a sense. And I think the last symphony is, I mean, you can read it as a joke. You can read it as a sort of a fart in the face of mortality to that final bassoon note. But also, you know, there's something quite serious about it when we think about his Nielsen's view of the life force and the life spirit. There's some very interesting writing on this from Daniel Grimley, the musicologist from Oxford, who talks about the kind of Darwinian qualities of the symphony. You know, instruments kind of emerge, they get into fights, and they either survive or they don't survive, and then a new one comes along. And it's a very
and the bassoon is the survival of the fittest. So the bassoon is the greater, best instrument.
Yeah, or maybe the bassoon is, you know, you have to laugh.
Yeah.
Because otherwise you'd cry. And I think in the end, you know, I guess, you know, what would he have been like to have around? You know, when you talk about which of the great composers would you like to meet? I mean, no way would you have wanted to meet Wagner. No way would you have wanted to meet like Beethoven. But Nielsen, you know, he would have been fantastic fun to meet. And I'm sure to have a few beers with, and, you know, probably suffered from bipolar disorder. He had some very kind of severe challenges, emotional challenges, and strange behavior. But he would have been fun, and he wouldn't have wanted to put you down. As you know, as a journalist, when you're interviewing people, and you're always worried that you're going to make a fool of yourself. I don't think you ever would have felt that with Carl Nielsen. He would have, you know, put you at ease from the.
He would have made a fool of himself before you had a chance to.
Exactly. Yeah, unless you were like, you know, idiotic towards him, which he would have taken you down pretty quickly.
Or Ruud Longgaard.
Oh God! Yeah, I mean, imagine those two together. I mean, I still don't know whether, you know, the circumstances under which they met and spoke are very hard to sort of read about. But I would imagine Nielsen would have just been quite dismissive.
Well, let's say the end of Nielsen's Sixth Symphony. This is performed by the Royal Stockholm Philharmonic and conducted by Sakari Oromo. Can you discuss some of the lasting impacts that Nielsen's has on Denmark, starting with the Nielsen competition?
Yeah, the Nielsen competition, or competitions, perhaps I should say, they've really come into their own in the last decade or so. So we heard the winner of the last clarinet competition there, Blaz Barevec. Part of the prize is a recording to record the Nielsen concerto for the flute, the flautist, and the clarinetist. This is violin competition. flute competition and clarinet competition. There's also an organ competition and a chamber music competition. So yeah, that's a significant legacy. And it's the city of Odense, which is the main city on Fyn, where Nielsen was from, has sort of really taken him to its heart. And there's a fantastic symphony orchestra there. It's a good place to go and kind of see, you know, the kind of place where Nielsen was from. I mean, Denmark does a lot of hand-wringing about its past, you know, like likes to kind of chew over past success and ask whether it was really valid and, you know, what was its standing in the world. But I think Nielsen's legacy, beyond the songs that everybody knows, has been a certain acceptance of you know, the avant-garde, this idea of simplicity in music, even if it ultimately builds to something complex, is something that's very much present in Danish music. If you think about Per Nørk or Bent Sørensen, these are composers who like to work with simple ingredients and build them up into something, you know, which can be majestic but is fundamentally quite basic. The fight with Rulangor, I mean, Denmark feels a lot of shame about that. I think nowadays every composer gets heard, lots of young composers get recordings. There's room for everyone, and one could say perhaps that's a legacy of Rulangor being silenced. Perhaps not, I don't know. But most of all, I think there's still a feeling in Denmark that everyone should have a chance to be a success, you know, and everyone should have a crack at education. Things should be free. But Nielsen and Hans Christian Andersen have played a part in that. You know, these are kids who came from nothing and were given opportunity at a time when it wasn't guaranteed. And now, thankfully, it is guaranteed.
You can see that with Nielsen's dates, because as we've discussed, he was born just after this defeat to Prussia in 1864 and died just before the election of Denmark's first social democratic government in 1924. So, as you said, he's that transitional figure that helps sort of Denmark figure out what it wanted to be in the future.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, it would be very interesting to see how the next 150 years are for him. You know, there's been a lot of Carl Nielsen played in Denmark recently, much more so than when I first moved here. And the songs, you know, I wonder if people will still sing the songs in a century's time. I wonder how his symphonies will be viewed. That will certainly be interesting to see.
Well, it certainly will be very interesting. And you'll be there at the front line reporting for us on the developments of the Nielsen reputation in Denmark as we go forward, I'm sure. What are your other current plans?
I hope I will, yes. Other current plans. Can I plug my book? Is that allowed?
Of course.
That comes out in the spring. And, well, we have a Nielsen cycle just getting going here in Copenhagen with Fabio Luisi and the Danish National Symphony Orchestra, which will be released on Deutsche Grammophon next year. The first ever recording of the complete symphonies and concertos on Deutsche Grammophon.
He's made it to Deutsche Grammophon. The Germans have accepted him, finally.
Yeah, so that's something to listen out for, definitely.
Fantastic. Well, thank you very much, Andrew. Until next time.
Pleasure. Until next time. Thank you, Paul.
Thank you very much to my producer, Matt Groom, and thanks to you for listening.